afternoon, everybody. I think we're going to get going. That's okay. You can keep getting food. I want to welcome you to this afternoon's colloquium that we're calling the series on celebration of faculty careers. And this is a series, very briefly, this is a series that was started this past year to have our senior faculty, full professors who have been full professors for more than 7 years, to talk about their experience as a faculty member and then share it with their colleagues. And today we're very happy and privileged to have Professor Jan Allebach, who is going to give his talk. So Professor Jan Allebach is the Hewlett-Packard Distinguished Professor of Electrical and Computer Engineering, and he is a professor of quantitative psychology. He has a courtesy appointment in the Department of Psychological Sciences, and he has been at Purdue since 1983, and he has been a full professor since 1987, so I think you're okay to have this presentation. So we're looking forward to all the exciting things he wants to share with us.
Thank you very much.
Before Jan gets started, I want to mention that Jan was elected to the National Academy of Engineering this year, which is an honor.
Thank you. Well, thanks to everyone for coming. This is a wonderful opportunity. I really appreciate your taking time from your busy schedules to come to my presentation. For those of you who had a chance to read, when I was writing the abstract, which Marcia had to prod me a bit to get, I became a little bit reflective about how all this started. And I said a few things about my days as a teenager in the dark room printing photographs, and this was a photograph I printed when I was about 16 years old, and the image quality here isn't great, but it has this nice range of tonality from very pure whites to very dark shadows, and that was what I thought, maybe that's how I got interested in digital halftoning, which we'll be talking about a bit. Okay, so this is the synopsis. And by the way, every examination that I go to, I always ask the student, how many slides do you have? And then I render an opinion. So I have 60 slides, so that's too many, but I'll go through some of them quickly. I will be finished in 50 minutes, I promise. Okay. So we're going to talk, I always say no student who ever worked for me came here thinking they were going to do research in printing, especially not in an ECE department. So I want to talk a little bit about why print is important, and one way to approach that is to think about it as an element of communication. Then we'll go into kind of the overview of what I've been doing for the last 10 years, 12 years or so. Then we'll focus in a little bit on digital halftoning because that's been a major area of activity. Then this is the new stuff here, or the relatively new material, digital commercial printing, what we've been doing in that space, and then finally some totally new dimensions for digital printing. I also want to mention I had a lot of trouble thinking about, well, what am I going to cover? I have been so many projects over since 83, over 30 years. So I came up with the following, and I also felt really I didn't want to cover some students' work and not some other students' work, so here's what I decided. I'm not going to talk about anything that any of you students are currently doing. I'm only going to talk about work that previous students did, except for the very last slide. So I apologize if you were hoping to see some discussion of your work, but I value what everyone does tremendously, and I just didn't want to leave anybody out, and it was impossible to cover everybody. So communication. If you think about this, back before 1450, there was an oral, people could sit together and talk. We could give a lecture, such as I am doing right now. And of course, there was written material, but it had to be generated pretty much by hand. This is an example from the Book of Kells, which is a famous series of very beautifully illuminated materials. Then in 1450, Gutenberg invented the movable type press. Now, of course, there were some things before that. We had to have paper, so that happened in 1238. But it's really amazing. In 50 years, more than 9 million printed books were in circulation. It's incredible how quickly that caught on, thinking about the time frame that we're talking about here. Then there are some more recent inventions, lithography. I'm not going to talk about the details of what that means, but that's basically the underpinnings of today's commercial printing process. And then in the 1900s, the principle of the offset press, which uses a rubber transfer blanket, was developed. And this was, until very recently, the mainstream way that commercial printing of documents such as this would have been done. Okay, so now, part two of this revolution, as I think of it, in communication, broadcast communication, was the development of the electronic broadcast communication. And so we had radio, which was invented around 1900, television, then there were commercial broadcasts in the 1920s. Here's a picture of Tesla demonstrating wireless transmission. So that all happened, and that's a broadcast medium where a few people could broadcast to a very large audience, but not something that everyone had access to. The average person certainly couldn't access this type of capability. Then we had the second revolution, which is personal broadcast, print communication. So now, and this all happened very interestingly, as Claude, when he introduced me, he said, I came here in 83. Well, right after I came here, there were four revolutionary things that happened. Apple introduced the Macintosh PC with this very graphical interface. HP introduced their first laser printer. Adobe introduced the PostScript language, which is a paid description language. And then finally, Altus developed PageMaker, which was one of the earliest tools for laying out a page and creating a document and creating that PostScript file. So that all happened very, very quickly. And now anybody who could use a computer like this could create a very nice looking printed document and have multiple copies of it printed. Okay, then the second revolution moved from personal broadcast communication of print but to electronic. And I think of all these media, which in my lifetime are relatively recent, email, web, blogs, Twitter, wiki, social networks, and then here is the website announcing the seminar that I'm giving right now. So now we've gone all the way from, you know, an individual being able to create a printed document and distribute that widely to having an individual be able to disperse or broadcast information electronically. And then finally, and I'm not going to say very much about this, but this is a very important area currently in some of the research that we're thinking about. So I really should have something at the end of the talk, but I don't. There's this notion of closing the loop. So we go from electrons to print, and then we take the print and we scan it, and we extract metadata from that print that is not visible. So for example, in this particular print, there is metadata embedded in the border of this form. We've modulated the edge of the position. It wiggles back and forth in a way that's imperceptible to the human viewer, but which actually can contain a code that can be decoded. So this is like a QR code in a sense. The difference is you don't notice that it's there. That's the key idea. Okay. So now, why printing? Well, I won't go through all these details. Paper still, for me, holds some special attraction as something to look at, although I get into discussions with some of my colleagues, including Raghu, as to whether some people like to look at things on paper and some people like to look at displays. It is still a big business, definitely in the commercial printing realm, but it's changing the role. Remember, we used to have filing cabinets. We used to print stuff and put it in the filing cabinet. Who does that anymore? Now you have a file somewhere electronically. So the only time you print is when you want somebody to be able to read something in this particular graphical user interface. And of course, future growth, this is probably, no, I shouldn't say probably, this is definitely a declining area with the rise of tablets, smartphones, all types of electronic media. I don't print as much as I used to, no one does. So the future growth in the printing industry is really at the higher end. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes here. Okay, so what makes printing industry interesting is that it's an incredibly complex process. And I've got architecture here, which I'm not going to talk about in detail, but this is a typical inkjet printer. This is a typical laser electrophotographic printer. There's many mechanisms, there's gears, there's all kinds of things. So it's really quite a complex system. Now, the part that I've been most involved with is the imaging pipeline, and that also is quite complex and involves many different steps. And one of the things that I found when I first started working with HP was this last little box here called halftoning is the one that actually consumes the most resources on this entire pipeline. Okay, it's also very demanding. Colorant is messy. It's paper. We have to put this wet stuff on paper, control where it goes, control what its appearance is. With electrophotographic printer, we're trying to control electrostatics, so we set up fields, and then we attract toner to the relative locations of where the fields are strongest. So, for example, this represents four identical patterns as far as what the digital print was. It's right here, this little 3x3, but you can see the appearance is quite different. So it's a very unstable process. There's massive amounts of data. We're talking on the order of, if we look between 10 to 100 pages per minute, at 22 to 225 megabytes per second. This is in a little box that you can get for $50 or $100. The marketplace pressure is intense. Everybody wants printers to be faster. They want more features, print wirelessly, print from your smartphone. Everybody still wants higher quality, and of course, it needs to be cheaper. And then finally, Moore's Law doesn't apply to printing because the paper isn't getting smaller. You still have to put something on an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. Okay, so that's my motivation. Now let's talk a little bit about what we've been doing at Purdue. And I'm not going to go through a lot of detail here. I won't go through any detail, to be quite honest, except for a few things. I just want to give you a sense of the breadth of the work that we've done. We've worked with all the major vendors in a variety of different topics, which are listed in parentheses. HP is on the next slide because there's many, many more topics for that particular relationship. I'll mention here we just started working with a small company called Poshmark, which is looking at aesthetics of fashion photography. So this is kind of an avenue of growth. That has come out of some of the high-end printing work we've done. This is not really printing, but the idea of looking at aesthetics of images is. It's very multidisciplinary. These are all the various faculty who have worked with us over the years. Young Liu is our newest faculty member, and I'll tell you what project he's working on with us in a minute. We've also had a long-term collaboration with George Chu and ME, Mark Lato, UNV, and IE, and then finally, whenever we want to look at something and know what people will think in terms of quality, we get Zig Pizel involved, and he's been a great collaborator. Okay, so now here are all the HP projects, and again, this is way too much to talk about in any detail. I'll just cover the main major headings. So there's low-level image rendering, which includes a variety of different steps. And I'll give some examples of things that have gone into product. That was another differentiator. I thought I won't talk about anything any students are currently doing, and I will mostly focus on things that went into product. So that's what I'll be talking about in a minute. Some of these things have been related to digital photography. Here we were working with the inkjet division, and they wanted people to print more photographs. This is related to security application. This is the newest project that Young Liu is working with us on, adaptive power management. And then we've done a lot in the area of image quality, and we continue to do that. Another aspect of that, or another view of image quality, is artifact detection. And then finally, and this is also an ongoing area, and I'll talk more about this, is the development of web-based troubleshooting tools to help customers solve their color printing issues. Okay, so these are just a subset of the products that we have technology in at this time, ranging from inkjet printers to the very large Indigo press. These are some of the different technologies that have gone into the products, and I'll show some of these, but not all of them, on the next couple slides. This was actually our first product success, and this was a collaboration with Charlie Bowman. And we were asked if there was some way we could synthesize more detail in images that needed to be scaled up to print. You don't get a real good sense here with the projector and the viewing distance, but the one on the right should look sharper than the one on the left, should show a little extra detail. So this is in the driver of every HP inkjet printer that's been sold since the mid-1900 or 2000 time frame. This is a half-toning algorithm, and we'll come back and talk a lot more about this later, so I'm not going to say too much about it now, but this is in the ASIC chip of every HP inkjet printer that has been sold since around 2000. So it's in, they were at one time selling about 1 million units a month, so it's in hundreds of millions of units, actually. And so now this is a test page that we designed for the laser jet products, the mid-range and high-end laser jet products. This is still being used in the products. Some of you I know are working with current PQTS tools, and this should look somewhat familiar to you. It changed a little, but it's basically the same. And this is a recent version of our web-based PQ defect diagnostic tools. These are live for 20 different mid-range color laser jet products. The customer prints a series of test pages and then examines them to see what their defect is. Then they go down through a troubleshooting tree where we show them potential issues that might arise. That's one of the challenges of the research, is to simulate these issues. And then we propose diagnostic procedures. They try the diagnostic procedures and then print the test pages again to see if it solved the problem. Okay. This is another algorithm that's in the hardware. This since about 2010 for low-end multifunction devices which print and scan. This is sort of interesting because we had previously developed a solution for printing from scanned documents, which this basically made obsolete. This was some work done with Mimi Bouton and Charlie Bowman. And now again, the quality of this projector is pretty poor, but you can see there's a halftone pattern here. And if I were to print that with a traditional clustered dot periodic halftone process, I would get horrible moiré pattern. So what we want to do is eliminate that without unduly blurring the detail in the image. So that's basically the difference between the left and the right. This HFD stands for hardware friendly. We had an earlier version that was based on our image scaling algorithm, but that could not be implemented in hardware. So they said, can you do something that will work in hardware? Okay. This is a project that a student actually is currently working on, but this is work that was done before he started. Chang, where are you? Somewhere around here. So this is automatic page classification. So when you walk up to a device like this, you always just press the button that's green and say, make a copy or scan it. If you went down into the menu, you would see that there are actually choices that you could make to improve the quality. So what this work does is it looks at various features of the image and then decides what process pipeline should be used autonomously. We're using some machine learning, currently using some machine learning approaches for this. This is in the firmware for the low-end laser jet MFPs. October 2012, we celebrated our 20th anniversary. This was a poster session we had to review some of the project, and these are most, but not all, the students who are working on the project. Many of them are in the room here now. This is Dr. Ken Lindblom, who serves on our ECE advisory board, and Mr. Lou Witkin, who has been a longtime supporter of the effort. He retired from HP just recently after 40 years of service. So this was a very exciting occasion. And this is a poster that we had in the atrium to commemorate some of the leading outcomes. And this was done by Ali Jahanian, who's in the back there. So the funding overall at this point in time is about $20 million. Some of that is for education also. This master-sponsored research agreement has been critical to allowing us to start new projects very quickly. It was established in 1997, then renewed in 1999, and then by 2004, Purdue was looking at it and thinking, well, you know, we know this technology is going into a lot of products, and we haven't gotten a lot of royalty dollars, from that. And HP was looking at it and saying, well, we now have a corporate policy for making relationship with university. This doesn't align with that. So maybe we need to renegotiate this master agreement. So they looked at each other, and they said, we better just leave it alone. They did one thing, which was they extended it to perpetuity. So we now have an agreement that will last as long as we're around here to do this sort of thing. HP endowed a professorship, which I have the honor of being the recipient in 2006. Overall, and these numbers are a little bit old, but 46 PhDs, 13 master's students, and these are all the students who have worked on HP-sponsored projects, 29 patents or patent applications filed, quite a number of refereed papers, conference papers, and then, of course, I've already told you about the technologies, and I'll talk a little bit more about this award later on. And then 2006, we were recipients of the Purdue University College of Engineering Team Award, so we were very honored to receive that. Okay, so now we're about halfway through the outline. That looks pretty good. And so we'll talk about digital halftoning, which is a specific research area that I picked because it's been a core activity, continues to be a core activity, and in terms of product impact and recognition of the work we've done, it probably stands out. Okay, so some of you have seen these slides before. So first of all, just an introduction as to what is digital halftoning. It's a process of rendering a continuous tone image with a device that is capable of generating only two or a few levels of gray. So this is just to illustrate increasing resolution. Depending on where you're sitting in the room, the right viewing distance would be where you no longer can resolve these dots with your eye. So the human eye is critical to this process. This, unfortunately, is exceeding the resolution of our projector, and so we're seeing some artifacts here that are basically beat frequencies or moiré patterns. Okay, now, of course, nobody wants to look at patches of constant tone. We want to look at detail, and so we can locally modulate those halftone textures to achieve the rendering of detail. And there are many, many different ways to do this. Generally, they can be categorized into what are called point-to-point processes, and a screen is an example of that, and this is extremely widely used for commercial printing. Screens can be clustered dot, as you see here. They can be dispersed dot. We'll talk about this a little bit more later. Then at the next level, we do something called air diffusion, which is a neighborhood processing method. For those of you who have some comm background, this is basically sigma-delta modulation. And then finally, at the extreme in terms of best quality and most computational cost, we have iterative methods, and our particular method is called direct binary search, and I think it's basically accepted to be the gold standard for the best quality iterative halftoning algorithm method. Okay, so now this is a slide to sort of give you an idea of the framework within which we develop these optimal rendering algorithms. So this actually can be applied to the resolution synthesis algorithm I talked about earlier, but it's very applicable to halftoning. So I think it's worth looking at it. It kind of gives you a sense of how we think about these problems. So we have training data, which could be constant tone patches that we want to render, or it could be a halftone that we're trying to emulate. We have some architecture for our rendering algorithm, which has some free parameters. We then develop a quality metric to compare what we're trying to match with our training data to what the rendering algorithm is creating. The quality metric could factor in features that account for the rendering device, or it could factor in the human visual system. And so, based on the output of the quality metric, we could have a search strategy that will, subject to constraints, optimize these free parameters of the algorithm. And so I'm going to show you just two examples of how we've done this. There are others, of course, but we don't have time to do all of them. So the first one is this so-called direct binary search algorithm that we have developed. The idea here is we have a continuous tone image, that's our training data. Here's our human visual system model. It's a very simple model, just a low-pass filter. I'm showing it here for monochrome, but we have color versions as well. So this represents the point spread function of the human visual system. It's sort of the image that a small point would create on your retina. So the idea would be, here are our halftone images. We filter those with the same human visual system model. If there's no difference between these two, we've achieved our goal. We visually, at least according to our model, the human viewer cannot distinguish between the continuous tone image and the halftone image. So that's what we would like to do. So now what we're going to do is we'll compute a simple error metric, mean squared error, which works quite well in this application, and then we will use that to derive changes in this halftone image. And the algorithm that we actually use to derive the changes is very, it's a heuristic. It's a simple search heuristic. Here's a portion of a halftone area. We're going to scan through it pixel by pixel. At every pixel, we stop and we look at the local neighborhood. And then we consider some changes that would be possible for this particular binary halftoning algorithm. We might toggle the state of the center pixel from white to black. We might swap this pixel to from the upper left corner to the center, and so forth. So for this particular case, there are four possible changes that we could make. We make all those changes, examine the effect that they have on the error, and of course you have to bear in mind that that's we're accounting for the human visual system in that process, so there's actually could potentially be a lot of computation, and then we accept the pattern that has the lowest error, which could be the original. So if none of them were lower, we just keep the original. We go on to the next pixel. We scan through the entire image. After we have covered all the pixels, we go back again. Yes, sir?
So how can you verify that your human visual model is actually correct?
Well, that's a very good question. It's based on psychophysical data. But correct is, the human visual system is very complex. So it's clearly a model. It accounts for some features of the human visual system. It doesn't account for all the complexities of human vision. That's a very good question.
Yes?
Yeah.
So is that an assumption that it's a linearity under that, because you're actually looking at something and you're saying?
Yep. I tried to keep all the math out of this, by the way, and there is quite a bit. But you're absolutely right. We're assuming that this is a linear system, so that when you print these dots, there's a point spread function that's associated with the printed dot. That gets convolved with the point spread function of the human viewer. Generally, the point spread function of the human dot, the printed dot, is much smaller than that of the human viewer, so it looks like an impulse. So basically, it ends up just being the point spread function of the human visual system. Very, very good, very good question.
Is it true that the sum of the point spread functions actually work in ICE? Is that true?
It works quite well. Yeah. I mean, it's a reasonable model at that level in the visual system. It certainly wouldn't account for higher level aspects of cognition, things or specific field receptors for certain types of spatial frequency structures. In fact, there's a student somewhere here and we've worked on this for some time, these different multi-channel models, for example. So they can be much more complicated. The issue here was to do something that would work computationally. And unfortunately, that's one of the major contributions, but I'm not going to talk about it today. Okay, so now this is an illustration to show you how this works. We start with a randomly half-toned image. We go through the pixels one time, two times, four times, six times, and eight times, and you can see it converges quite quickly to something that has a rather appealing visual structure. And so now this is one of the things, and unfortunately the projector's not showing this very well, but this sort of illustrates the importance of doing that swapping. And from a linear system point of view, the reason swapping is important is because when you toggle, you're ripping out that whole point spread function or putting it in. So it's a big change. If you toggle, you're just pushing it slightly from where it's positioned to another location. So this allows you to do much more refinement. Okay. So that's DBS. Now, DBS, until recently, no one ever considered putting it in a product because it was too computationally intensive. I can't reveal the details, but there is a manufacturer that we're working with that is actually considering putting it in a high-end product. So that's kind of amazing. I've worked with them a little bit to make this algorithm more efficient, but a lot of it is what we had already done. Okay, so now this was a project that we were not asked to do. We were working with the Vancouver Inkjet Division, and the student was being supported by them, but you know, I forget exactly what he was supposed to be working on, but we got to talking about an idea for halftoning, which was to take this standard structure called air diffusion, and let me just briefly explain what that does. So you have you have your input, which now, this is your original image. We're going to be modifying it, so we call that the updated image. The pixel coordinates here are M and N. We're going to basically, just think of this as a threshold. So we'll quantize it or threshold it. That creates our binary output. And then what we do is at this pixel location, we look at the difference between what we wanted, which is this, and what we got. That's our error signal, D. And then we feed that ahead to pixels where we have not yet made any decision. So for example, if the error is positive, meaning generally I think in terms of absorptance, so that means the image is too dark, we're going to take the negative of that. We're going to reduce the neighboring pixels to make it less likely that we'll print dots at those locations. And then we have a set of weights to do that. Now this algorithm has been around since 1976. It was developed at University of Illinois by a group that was working on the Plato project that was using, Plato was an online education system, but they were using flat plasma panel displays. This is long, long, long before flat panel displays became mainstream. And so they had a very smart guy who came up with this idea, two people, Floyd and Steinberg, actually. And they had a specific set of weights that they came up with via some trial and error. And that became error diffusion. There have been various modifications, but what the student, Ping Shan Lee, who worked on this, said, well, suppose we were to let these weights be dependent on the actual input gray value. The idea being that in a highlight where dots are far apart, maybe you want to weight distribute the area a little different than in the mid-tone where the dots are close together. Totally heuristic idea. We had no idea if it would work, but once you have that that architecture, then you think about, well, how would we train it? Well, the way to train it we came up with was to say, well, we have this thing called DBS that generates the best quality dispersed dot binary textures. Why not try to get this to mimic DBS? And so that's how we did the training. And this is the flow diagram. I'm not going to go, it's done in the frequency domain, so we're really trying to match the spectrum that the DBS halftones has. So we'll skip over this. This shows as a function of gray level, absorptance 0 is white, and absorptance 1 is black. So these are the weights positions. So you can see that at different gray levels, we are indeed distributing more of the error to different pixel positions. And by the way, I should mention we're scanning in raster order here. This is the current pixel that we're processing. This will be the next one to process, and then these are on the next line. So. Then there's also some modification of the threshold. I won't describe that today. That's a little bit more detailed than we want to go into. But this shows the results. This was Floyd and Steinberg's algorithm. And it has some well-known artifacts, these warming artifacts especially. These are startup issues, which could be remedied in a variety of ways. You see some warming artifacts here. Also, Floyd Steinberg goes into these little, what I call, texture clicks. Where it gets into a very specific type of pattern that's highly regular, but then when it moves out of that pattern, you see a contour, basically. So the tone-dependent air diffusion doesn't have those limitations, and the real proof of the pudding is to compare tone-dependent air diffusion with direct binary search, and the dots are in different places, there's no question about that, but visually they are indistinguishable. In terms of their overall appearance. So that was the work that led to my being given the Daniel Noble IEEE Field Award, which I received in Melbourne, Australia this past September. So I was very honored to get that kind of recognition for this work. And that pretty much, oh, one more thing. So I wanted to mention that we're continuing to do halftoning work. And this is just one example of some of the things we're doing. This is of great interest currently to Indigo, the Indigo half division of Israel with the high-end presses. This is a clustered version of direct binary search. And the idea of doing the clustering is to make it more stable for various printing applications. And of course, this is really, for purposes of illustration, this is much lower resolution than you would normally view this in terms of the image detail. The other thing I wanted to mention was that this algorithm was a very serendipitous discovery, because the student was trying to write the code to implement DBS, and he made a mistake. And he came to me and he said, oh, my code isn't working correctly. I got this result. It wasn't exactly this image, but I looked at that and I thought, that might be useful. So we worked on it. That led to a very nice paper in the IEEE Transactional Image Processing, and it's been a very successful outcome of our work. And one other thing, we've done some very extensive psychophysics comparing this dispersed dot, stochastic, clustered dot, halftone patterns with some competing methods in the literature and asking subjects which looks smoother. And they've overwhelmingly preferred our method. So we were very happy with that. That we haven't actually published yet, at least not in print. Okay, so now we're ready to move on to more current things. Well, not more current things, but some of the newer things that we're also doing, because as I said, we continue to do all these other things that I talked about. So I want to talk a little bit about commercial printing and what that has led to. So this is, some of you may be familiar, especially if you participated in the College of Engineering Strategic Planning activity. This was one of the resources that we use. It's a book called Blue Ocean Strategy. And the idea is that if you want to have a large impact and a success, you work in an area where there aren't a lot of other people who are competing, where they haven't recognized the opportunity. And digital printing is an example of that, because when you look at all the pages that are printed globally, in a year, there's only a tiny slice that are done digitally. And so a number of companies have moved into this field. It's been tough competition, but HP has fortunately done very well. So this is the traditional method. I mentioned earlier offset lithography. These are some of the traditional so-called impact printing methods. This was actually the press that Purdue Printing Services used to have before they cut back their business significantly. And this is an example or an illustration of the Indigo press that HP developed. And it's basically very much like a laser jet printer, except it's big, and it uses liquid toner rather than dry toner, which has a lot of very interesting impacts. But so this actually, Purdue Printing Services still has one of these. I don't know how long they'll keep it, because I don't know how many people have heard, but they outsourced all their printing to Xerox. So it's now a managed printing operation run by Xerox, not HP. So that, I thought that was interesting. But anyway, so now these are some of the newer Indigo products. The Indigo division has been extremely successful. This is big enough to print cardboard cartons. And that's very important, as I'll mention in a minute. We talked about the fact that printing is changing, and people don't do as much printing as they used to do, but we still need packaging. It's hard to imagine the world without packaging. And so that's an opportunity to use these kinds of technology. This is another technology that has been developed, which is also extremely large. This is a place where a person can climb up the steps and stand, so you can imagine how big this thing is. This is one of the applications that they had marketed, that they had targeted for this, is books on demand, textbooks on demand. It's fully inkjet. It's not laser electrophotographic, but it is digital. So this is an example. Every page that comes out is different. In the traditional printing process, you make a plate, you ink the plate, you print a page, you ink it again, you print another page. It's always the same page. Whereas with digital technologies, every page can be different. And that's one of the major differences between digital and traditional analog printing technology. Okay, so this is the final large system that HP has on the market. This is by another division, also in Israel, that we're currently working with, called Cytex. And this is this can be used for point of sale, posters, billboards, you know, that sort of thing. So this is using UV cured ink, so it's a very, very robust colorant. Okay, here are some of the applications. I've already mentioned a couple of these. Books, periodicals, catalogs. This is called marketing collateral. Purdue University does a lot of this in advancement. I just recently received the College of Engineering Impact Report, printed document, very nicely printed, very high quality. You want to convey a sense that you're doing very good work, so you want your work to be represented in a very high quality format. Financial and legal documents, and then of course packaging, which I just mentioned, technical documents. This probably is one area that is going much more electronic as relative to these some of these others. Okay, now, so the question, so we were starting to move into this space, and we were working with HP Labs in Palo Alto. I actually had a sabbatical, my previous sabbatical, which was whatever that interval is, 6 years, 7 years ago. So I was looking at, you know, okay, what are the hurdles to the success of digital commercial print? And one of the prop for, you know, having it be more accessible rather than you having to go to a professional designer, for example. So one of the hurdles is the tools to create high quality output require far too much skill. So this is a screenshot from Adobe InDesign, which is the current market-leading document design tool. It's very complicated, very hard to use. I mean, you need to be doing this full-time if you're going to be able to successfully use this tool. Even for a skilled user, it's a very time-consuming process. So we wanted to try to automate some of those things. The other issue is that in this digital era, we just have far too much content. It's very hard to manage. So this is just an example of my own, some of my own content. These are shots from a hike we took in the North Cascades. And so, you know, everybody has photos. How do you manage them? How do you keep track of them? What do you do with them? So this is one of the things we were also thinking about. And so our overall goal of this program was to drive more pages to the press, by providing more attractive options for users to create visual document, provide the capability to achieve results that look as though they were created by a professional designer, and provide capability for the user to more effectively manage document content and style. And so this is still an ongoing area of activity. There are at least three students who are working on projects related to this, but as I said, I decided I wasn't going to specifically mention what the students are currently doing. Instead, I'm going to give you one example, which is from some work that a former student did. And the idea here, these are general principles of being able to combine ideas from aesthetics and design with concepts from image analysis and image understanding, and then also still understanding what are the limitations of the reproduction device and medium. So this particular project was to create a distinctive photo album page. You wouldn't do every page this way. It could be like dividers, section dividers, or a cover. You have sort of a background photo, and then what you want to do is put small photos that are spaced around the background without hiding something that's important. So this is called layering and transparency. And when HP approached us, they had already developed some very sophisticated layout architecture, but it just created white pixels on pictures on a white background. They said, we've never done anything with layering and transparency. And I had done some projects with our design group here in printing services. They always loved to use layering and transparency. So the idea was, could we automate that? So I'm going to just show you a couple slides here to illustrate the approach that we take. Here are the major steps, and we'll break these down a little bit. First of all, you select your background photo. And that's done, we'll talk about it in a minute. And then we select the small photos. Finally, we place the small photos. The entire process is autonomous. You just give it a folder with the photos, and it does everything. The background, looks like there's some animation here. I was try to get rid of the animation, but in any case, we're doing some saliency analysis here. This is a very hot topic in image analysis these days, to understand which areas of the image are important. And then the idea is we won't put background photos on top of the salient regions of the image. So this, for example, we ended up, this is a relatively simple example, but the idea would be you put the background photos around the Big Ben Tower. Then you start to characterize, how do you decide where you're going to put the photos? How big should they be? And so we used a number of different features, some to extract the dominant linear dimensions, because there's a lot of aesthetic theory that says that you form a visual path and you want this to be consistent. And then we did various other further work with the saliency map of the background image to decide where to put the images. And so forth. So this is actually a photo of the student Maria Ortiz, who did the work when she was visiting Paris, and then she ended up going to work in Paris, where she still is. And I'll talk a little bit more about that at the very end. Here's some more animation with the Huff transforms. There's another something else here called the rule of thirds that talks about how you want to position content in an image. So there's partly a process here deciding, are these good small photos or are they poor small photos? And then finally, the photo placement is based on choosing a certain visual path. In this case, that's the visual path, and there are a couple of other templates that we have. And then also based on color analysis of the images and some other features. And this sort of shows some of the, there's the visual path that I mentioned. Then we go through and refine it. Interestingly, this refinement was based on an experiment we did with designers, where we gave the designers the preliminary design. We gave them a GUI. So it was all done remotely. These designers were all in Indianapolis. And we said, move these photos around, resize them, do what you would do to make the design better. So when we got that information, then Maria said, well, I looked at what they've done, and I think I can make some changes, refinements to my algorithm to account for that. And so this sort of shows one of the things, the designers tended to want to more consistently arrange the photos, but it's not quite so obvious here.
Okay,
that's a good point. So she developed some other methodologies here and then of course this is not what the designer did. This is actually after her optimization. So these are some final results for a couple of different backgrounds. These are her personal photos from a trip to Paris and also a trip to London. So that's how that project wrapped up. As I said, it spawned a number of different other activities, some of which are ongoing with current students. So now we're at the very, very end, and we're right on time. I said I could do it. New dimension for digital printing. I think I only have two or three slides here. So 2.5D relief printing is a new printing technology that allows us to put layers of colorant on a medium. It could be useful for packaging, it could be useful for artistic reproduction, things of that sort. This is some work. This is Maria again. So she's working for Canon Osei, which is a division of the Canon company in Paris. They're the ones who we've been working with on this activity. We've had a number of interns go over. This work was done by Jan Yu Wang. It hasn't been published yet, and I'm not going to tell you too much about it because they're still considering whether they want to file for some intellectual property. An earlier project done by another student, Qing Liu, who also did an internship in Paris, involved this whole issue of characterization. How do you measure image quality with this type of content? And so she did a very comprehensive study of different methods. This is just one example where we take this height map that's based on scanning and then do a light reflection simulation to see what would it look like visually and then compare it to the real print. And then also do that for the ideal height map and see how close did we get to what we wanted to do in terms of the visual appearance. So, and we have another student who's going to go over there. This, none of this was done with any psychophysics, so we have another student who will be starting in the beginning of the summer, and she's going to be, at least the plan, was to look at psychophysics and see what subjects actually say. So the last topic is some work that I've been doing with a number of faculty. This slide is from a number of presentations we've given. This is some work I'm doing with faculty over in Burke, including Keenam. And we're looking at a variety of different types of applications where we could use printing technologies to do roll-to-roll nanomanufacturing. And so one area could be pharmaceuticals, which could also include anti-counterfeiting features. This is a very, very major problem in the industry, the pharmacy industry. So we're, we think there are some opportunities there. And then there are other, we're looking at food packaging as an area where we could protect the quality of food or allow tracking of what the food package has experienced during transit. And then the third one is tying into some of the work that Babak Zaidi's been doing in the area of paper-based materials. He basically does printing research. And the idea, for example, would be, for example, smart diapers that could be used in for in adults to monitor whether there's an issue with blood or other bodily fluids and so forth. So this is a major, major activity. I only mentioned the three different applications that were in a ERC proposal we submitted last summer, pre-proposal that we submitted last summer. But Ali Shakuri is investing a great deal of his resources to build this effort, and we have a very active group of faculty who are participating. So, clean G, right? Yeah. So, okay. So, to wrap up, that's another picture. This was taken when I was an undergrad at the University of Delaware. This is an area around Newark, Delaware, where I did my undergraduate at the University of Delaware. So, this is another one of my prints that I made. And it, unfortunately, the projector doesn't really do it justice, but I'm one of the prints that I particularly like. Looks a lot better on my laptop, actually. So, anyway, thank you very much. I think that's all I wanted to say. I appreciate your interest.
So, I don't know about all of you, but I heard Paris, I heard London. I think I want to join. Okay, I'm sure you'll be glad to take some questions.
Anybody have any questions? Yes, she.
So that you said a half-ton procedure is very computation, costly, expensive. Can it be done on the computer, desktop computer, which you have?
That's an excellent question. That is an excellent question. That's exactly the direction the industry moved in a few years ago, and it was called host-based printing. They said, gee, Intel's making all this progress with these chips. Let's steal some of their cycles and do the half-toning on the computer. Now, there's two problems, because once you half-tone the image, you're at print resolution. So then you have to send this thing down to the printer. And in fact, we developed an algorithm that was used in some products that it was sort of a fallback. If the buffer got too, if it was going to take too large to send, too long to send it down, then with this fallback, they would use our version of the algorithm. So now what led away from that was the rise of mobile devices. So who uses desktop computers anymore? You know, I actually don't. This is the only thing I use. There were a lot of products in the marketplace. There may still be, but now more and more, the phrase they use is that there are a proliferation of what are called on-ramps for printing. And it's actually impacted our research quite significantly, because some of the work we're doing, we want to get something called the object map, which tells you where there's text, where there's images, where there's graphics. And this is typically generated during the process of creating the page description language. But if you're printing from a mobile device, it doesn't necessarily have that full-featured object map. And so what we're having to do is actually work from the digital image and segment it, and then use image analysis methods to extract that object map to tell us where the different pieces are. So, good question. Yes, Margot.
So, I was looking at your career evolution, And then it's kind of interesting that the half-toning work is what I'd say is very traditional, you know. It's got systems, it's got loops, it's got, you know, feedback and all that stuff that most of us in ECE are comfortable with. And I look at your work on the things that come afterwards, for example, driving content to printing, that sort of work, or the work on automatic layout of an image dossier, right? Those seem very, very different. Can you talk a little bit about how you got to this comfort level of just reaching? Because you were talking about aesthetics, you're talking about all
right,
kinds of
right,
things.
Right. Well,
familiar things to most of us in ECE.
Right. Well,
yeah. How you make that?
Well, I mean, that's probably the reason I put that first picture in this last picture. So the thing is, I've always had a strong interest in aesthetics. But you're absolutely right. I never saw it as a component of what I was doing in terms of my research. And I've always been interested in design too, actually. Not just visual 2D graphic arts, but, you know, furniture, you know, that sort of thing. And so, I mean, basically, it was an opportunity. It was Chin Lin, who was our outstanding electrical engineering advisor. She said, "Do you have a sabbatical coming up?" And I said, "Well, yeah, but I can't really take a sabbatical because I've got too many projects going. I can't just leave for 6 months." So she said, "Well, what could you do?" And so I said, "Well, I could, you know, we could collaborate, and I'll come out and visit now and then." And they said, "Well, we have this problem. We want to be able to enable a small, medium business to create good-looking content without hiring a professional designer." And I knew nothing about it at that time, absolutely nothing. So I went and talked to designers around here on campus. They referred me to some delightful textbooks. And I just had a blast with it. I mean, it was really fun. I learned about the Bauhaus period in Germany when they developed that distinctive types of architecture, the modernist period, the postmodernism. It was really fun. And then I would go and give seminars at HP Labs to her department and tell them what I was learning and how it might influence what they were doing. And then finally, that led to the actual project of the photo book layout. And then there's been three or four other projects that have sort of spun off from that. Magazine cover design, another one reformatting. So we have a document that you've created, for example, this. You know, maybe I think this is a wonderful layout, for example, but I want to put something about my research project. So I basically autonomously figure out what this layout is, and then I autonomously give it pictures and text, and it drops it back in there so that you get something that looks like this, but now it's my research. It's not this university program. So
that may not be the end point, and after that you could maybe move things around a little bit to do a final tweak.
Right.
It's a good start.
Yes, exactly. So yeah, there's always a continuum of possibilities that could be. But yes, it's been, I really enjoyed it. It's been really fun moving into this area. Yeah. So
I know you mentioned Professor Pizzo and you're collaborating, right? So can you kind of give us a very brief description of what it is that makes us like a picture better than another picture?
Ali, where are you? this is actually what Professor Pizzo does not like to study. He wants to study things that are very quantifiable and measurable, so he does perception. He doesn't like to get up to that higher level, unless it's robotics and figuring out. He's changing a little bit, how people solve traveling salesman problem, for example. But yeah, there's been quite a bit of work on this, but there's an enormous amount of space available. I mean, I guess I would have to say that the approach that we're taking at this point, and that Poshmark project is an example. There's a student, Ming Chen, around here somewhere who did that work, and we're switching to a new student. But, you know, they said, okay, so Poshmark is a company. You have clothing. It's all for women. Men don't do this. You have clothing that you want to sell. So you hang it on a hanger. You put it on a mannequin. You take your smartphone and take a picture. And they have an app that will upload it to what's called your closet. And you put a price on it, you give it a little description, and then other people can go look at your closet and they can bid on it. And they just say, "I'll give you this for it." And then the company once they go to the website and say, I want it, the company sends them the mailer. They put the clothing in the mailer, in the package with the mailer, send it to the customer. Customer says, I got it. Poshmark bills the seller, or no, bills the customer, and takes their cut and then gives the rest of the money to the seller. They've been extremely successful. In fact, it's amazing to me that, I mean, we're the first university they've worked with, and it's amazing to me that a startup would be willing to get into something with a university. But what they were interested in was, they said, you know, people take pictures with their smartphones, they're not photographers, the quality could be terrible. We'd like some way to be able to, A, understand what is the level of quality of the photos, and maybe even later we could give them some ideas about how to improve the quality of the, you know, retake the picture, basically. So the approach we did was to, Ming, I'd have to say, was to extract a wide range of features, some of which, I mean, there's a lot of research going on in this area that are known to be related to image quality. Saliency is one, you know, where are the salient regions compared to, there's a traditional rule of photography called the rule of thirds, that you want to put things at the vertices of three, you draw three lines, two horizontal and two vertical, and those four vertices, that's where you want your content to be. Now, why do people prefer that? That's where the theory comes in, I think if anybody's looked at that at all, it's probably Ali, but in any case, he extracts quite a range of features, and then we do machine learning. So we had subjects look at photos, rank their quality, and then we develop a machine learning framework to predict what the subject would say. And we're getting within, on a scale of 1 to 10, we're getting within 2, what is it, Ming? 2 unit standard deviation or 1? Beg your pardon? Yeah, more, a little around 2 unit standard deviation. So it's not perfect, but, you know, it tells you a lot. Let's just put it that way. It's a good question. Yes.
So do you have any, you know, it's more for, not for your research, it's more about, you know, general, you know, advice for the junior faculty member, so that, you know, based on my experience, what do you have to focus on one thing as a junior faculty member so it can be successful? I don't know.
Well, yeah, that's a very good question. And I'm sorry, what's that? No, I don't think. I think the main, I sort of sense that what's important is to have an identifiable area of impact so that when people talk about G, they can say, yes, he does this. And of course, it has to be something that's important. You know, one of my popular phrases is, you know, people come to me and say, you know, there's many, many interesting problems. I'll say, that's a really interesting problem, but no one's paying me to work on it. You know, so there's a sense of there's lots of interesting things to do, but there's some that are more important than others. So pick an important problem and become well known for the work that you've done, you know, focus in that area. And I think, if anything, the fact that I've been able to do what I've done in this area, which I would say, to me, it's an offbeat area of research for ECE, and yet achieve what I've been able to achieve suggests that, you know, there's a lot of opportunities to do that. You know, it doesn't have to be the mainstream problems, like for in my area, for example, image coding. That's a mainstream area, which, you know, quite frankly, it's one of the reasons I tend to be very skeptical about some of these traditional measures of publication success, like H-index and impact factor, because this is a relatively small community. There's not a lot of papers that are being published in this field, but it's very, very important. Compared to image compression, there's just papers everywhere that people are doing. So that, I think that was, oh, and then you have to like it. You have to be passionate about what you're doing.
So I guess there is a blue ocean.
Yeah, there is. There is that, definitely. There is that. That was the image coding I did. There's so many people, I always say, I want to work on something that there aren't a lot of people doing. I always sort of have taken that tack, you know. So that's another good aspect.
So for people who haven't heard about it, the opposite is the red ocean, where there's so much blood in the water because people are fighting.
Right. All the sharks. Right.
All the sharks.
Yeah.
Anything else? Students, this is your chance to ask him the real question. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.